Welcome to a beautiful day in the mountains of Western North Carolina, where today we're going to talk about motorized bicycles. These are really cool and very inexpensive, and yes, you can do it for $300, and you can actually do it for a lot less than that. This is part of a bigger series that I'm doing on personal transportation for campers. So when you get to a campground or you get parked, you want to go travel. I've been looking at all sorts of different options today. It's about motorized bicycles. So what this is a standard bicycle that you buy or that you already have. If you already have a bicycle that this could fit on, your expenses may be as little as $100. So there's a lot of these kits online, and I'll put all the links to everything will be below to these kits, and they roughly run between $90 and $110 for the basic kit. Now you can do a higher end kit, and we're going to talk about performance upgrades in part three. But what I did, because I wasn't sure, I don't know anything about small gas engines. I'm not that mechanically inclined, but I'm the kind of person that I am willing to watch YouTube videos on how to do this. And I'm going to link two very good videos down below on how to do the step-by-step installation of this kit. So part one is going to be more about the bike, how it works. Part two, we'll take it out on the road test it. We'll go over the speeds and things like that. And then part three will be tips, modifications, and performance upgrades, because you can get these things to go pretty fast. Now, right out of the kit, the basic kit, the $100 kit, you're looking at probably between 25 and 27 miles per hour on flat grades. So what kind of bike do you need to put this on? If you have one at home, what you need to look for is you need a bike that has this open space here. So you need enough room to put the cylinder, to put the engine. It's not that big. This is a 26.5-inch bike, and it's a little narrow down here at the bottom, but I was able to fit it in with just one slight change. And so what you're looking for, and I'll put a couple pictures up here of this bike and then also another bike. Now, when you look at these assembly videos, they're all going to do beach cruisers, because that's what everybody starts out putting these on, because they look pretty cool. Do not put this on a beach cruiser, because that's where I started and it was a great big mess for a couple reasons. Number one, you have to disassemble the rear brake arm that's on ridiculously tight. I wasn't even able to get mine off. I took it to a mechanic, so he disassembled it, and when I put it back on the bike and reassembled it and started to ride it, it locked up and destroyed the bearings. So I took the rear wheel down to a bicycle shop. They repaired it for me. They rebuilt the brake and the bearings. I put it back on, and there's one little nut that I didn't tighten quite tight enough in the right direction with a specialized wrench, and when I rode it again, I completely destroyed the hub, the brake, everything. It was a total loss for the bicycle. Do not recommend putting it on the beach cruiser. Number two, the reason you want to put it on a bike that has speeds is that you can assist the engine if you're going up a steep hill or if you just want to pedal along with it. On a beach cruiser, once you hit about 15 miles per hour, 17 miles per hour, you can't pedal. The bike's going to be going faster than you can pedal. With this one, I can put it in seventh gear and I can help assist it going up a mountain. If it drops down to 17 miles an hour and I want to get it back up to 20 going up a hill, I can put it in seventh gear and kick it on up. And then I can also put it in first gear when I'm wanting to start the bike. So we're going to go over some of the parts about how this starts, because what I love about this bike is how simple it is and also how compact it is. So you can, this is a two-stroke engine, and I want to show you how small this is. It barely sticks out the side of the bike. Now you can get a four-stroke engine, but it's gonna be a lot wider. In fact, they'll supply you with pedal cranks because they have to come out. They have to come out a ways away from the bike to clear the engine. So it's a lot bigger. Now the advantages of the four-stroke is it's gonna be more fuel efficient, probably a little quieter. Okay, so let's go over the parts of the kit. So at the top here, you get your gas tank, and it bolts right here onto the frame. And then you have this little valve here, safety shut off. So whenever you're not riding it, you definitely want to shut that off. You get a fuel line. Now you get it. This is an upgraded fuel line, and I just got a better fuel line down at my local Lowe's under the mower section. Just got a better fuel line. The one that comes with it is not very good, and I got these hose clamps. So when I quoted the $300, I've got $150 in the bike, $100 in the kit, and then I did about $50 in upgrades. So this is the fuel filter that comes along with it. My understanding is this is the direction it goes in. Comes with this carburetor. Now, one great thing about this whole kit is everything is so cheap. Let's say for some reason your carburetor goes bad and you need a brand new carburetor. You're looking at $15 to $18 for this whole assembly, the carburetor and the air cover and the air cleaner. So it's all one piece. So everything is so cheap. So basically your gas comes down through here. It goes into your carburetor. Your air comes in here. And then it goes through this intake tube. Don't worry about, this is a boost bottle attachment. I wouldn't worry about that. I'm just experimenting with it right now. It's really not critical to anything. And then it goes in here, and this is a single cylinder. And then the power comes in here, turns a gear here, which turns the gear here, which on the other side is your, well, which is all part of your clutch right here. Now, where's the starter? Well, there's no starter. There's no battery. Why don't you need a battery? Well, number one, it generates its own power, its own spark, through a magneto, which is inside here. And that goes up into this little power module. And in the process of building mine, I broke the connector right here. So this whole assembly was $8. Again, so cheap, so easy. So that sends the spark up through here. You mount this little one here, goes into your spark plug here, and this makes the spark. So how do you start the thing if you don't have any battery, if you don't have a pull starter? So let me show you the other side here. So here's my boost bottle. It's not as cool as it sounds. It's not nitrous, but you can get nitrous for these things, but I highly do not recommend it. You can also buy performance upgrades for different, all sorts of things. So here is your exhaust that comes out here. Just bolt that on. And the kit is really easy. Here's your intake, other side of that, and you just bolt that on. Now here is your clutch arm. So your clutch, you have a clutch, and when you pull the handle up there, this comes in and out, and that engages the engine or disengages the engine from this chain right here. So you have your chain here, comes around, goes into your sprocket, comes back around. You have a chain tensioner here, which I'll talk in performance upgrades. I tried the springy one, didn't like it. I also upgraded to a heavy duty chain because you do have to cut the chain to the right size, which is a little tricky, but it's not as tricky as it looks. Don't use the method in the video, which is using a chisel or a screwdriver and a hammer. Don't do that. You're just going to mangle the chain. I'll put a link below to the best chain breaker, and it's very simple to do with the proper tool. I used three different ones. This was the one I got that actually worked. The other ones didn't work so great. And then it's easy to go ahead and size it. Now, the most difficult part, they'll tell you right off, the most difficult part of this assembly is putting on this sprocket. It comes with a rag joint. And what the rag joint is it's a little bracket that goes on the spokes and squeezes this on. So it's held by tension between this and your spokes. It's, when you see it, you're just like, oh, that's not a very good setup. But they actually do hold up pretty well. And people go over 40 miles an hour with their upgrades and with that rag joint, and it lasts, so it's not so bad. But what you'll find is it's extremely aggravating and time consuming because you need to get this perfectly centered, and it needs to be perfectly centered in the middle and to the left, and so there's no wobble. The more time you spend on this and the better you get this, the less vibration you're gonna get in your whole assembly when you get up to speed. So what most people do after frustrating with this, and I frustrated with it for about a half a day because I was just trying to get it perfect and I couldn't because I would tighten the last one down and it would be off just a little bit. And I'm a bit of a perfectionist sometimes. So what I did is, and you can just go ahead and assemble it, ride it, get used to it, see if it's your thing. If it is your thing and you're having fun with it and you really wanna get, you work your way up to a little higher speeds and less vibration, then what you're gonna want to get is this hub adapter. Do not get the $38 one. I got the $38 one. It looked great. I noticed when I got it out of the package, the hole didn't seem to be quite round, and in the end it wasn't. So this does keep it really good for in this direction and this direction. But the problem is it's offset a little bit this way, so it tends to make some vibration going like that and pull on the chain. So I've ordered the better one, which is $60, and that is a hit, and I know it, but it's a CNC machine, and I'm gonna order that one. It should take care of being able to get that on. And what's great about this is you can adjust it real easy left to right because you want your chain geometry to be very good. So you want that sprocket to where it's lined up, and it's going straight into the other sprocket. Into there. So these are all things that just kind of help it as you put together. It's not big. Once you get this on, the rest of the process is really pretty straightforward and pretty simple. I watched the videos just over and over and over, and sure enough, when the time came, it was real simple to do because mounting the engine, real easy. You just have a joint here, and a joint here. You don't want to tighten everything down till you kind of get the chain in, because what happened was this fit perfectly without this little offset intake. This fit just perfect with everything that came, but what happened is to get the chain tension right, I had to rotate this up, and so I had to buy this little offset, which I'll put a link to, which just allows you to have a little extra room and let this be outside here. It doesn't hit my knee or anything. There's no problem with that. So the second problem with the beach cruiser is brakes. You do not, the beach cruiser only has one brake, which is a revert. When you reverse pedal, there's a little brake in the hub that is just not going to stop you very well. So what I would recommend is I go with the double calipers. So this is your caliper brake, one in the front and one in the back. The disc brakes are really cool. The problem with the disc brakes is there's just really not enough room. Once you can see everything that's going on here, and to add another disc in the brake assembly is just, it's just going to be too much trouble. I think you might be able to fit it on, but I just didn't want to have to go down that road. This is kind of the more involved end of the bike, so I just have the caliper brakes. So let's talk about speed. The speed is going to be dependent on mostly, right out of the box, the sprocket. So this is about a 42 or 44 tooth, that's these counting the teeth, sprocket. This is the one that generally comes with the kit. I really recommend this because it's a good balance between power and speed and being able to get up most hills. So I've been real happy with this one. You can go with a smaller sprocket, a 32, 34, 36, and that's gonna allow you to go faster. So as this is set up, the way I got it out of the box, I'm getting on as flat as I can get in Western North Carolina. I can cruise very nicely at 25 miles an hour. If I floor it, I can get 27, maybe 28. But what I need is I need power to get up mountains. So this has been wonderful to get up that. If I went down to a 32.46 sprocket, I could probably add another 7 miles per hour to my top speed. However, I'm going to lose torque, so it's gonna get more boggy trying to go up the hill. However, I could pedal more to get up the hill, so that may be something I might play with on down the road. But what happens is, right out of the box, these the $99 engines are about 1.5 horsepower. Now, in part three, I'll go over how you can get different kits if you want to pay a bit more money, and you can get up to about 2.9 horsepower out of that, which is going to allow you to run a smaller sprocket and a higher top speed. So that's what's kind of fun about this as a hobby, is you can do as much or as little, because once you get into it, you're kind of like, okay, I understand that, and hey, wouldn't it be cool to do a little faster, a little better, or have it run a little smoother? So those are kind of things you get into it, makes it a lot of fun. So let's go over the hand controls. It's really kind of simple. One little upgrade I did is to make it more simplistic. I got this double brake arm. So instead of having a left and right brake, both brake cables come into the same thing, and that simplifies this side. Over here is my throttle right there. And that means the only lever I have to deal with over here is the clutch lever, which is gonna how we're gonna get to about how they make this so simple and so compact. So instead of a pull start, what happens is you start pedaling and get up a little bit of speed, and it's kind of like a bump start on a manual car. So as soon as you let go of this, it's going to start turning the engine, it'll start making it spark, it'll start firing, and it starts itself up, then pull it back in, push this button down, and you can let it idle. And then to go, you just pedal, get up a little bit of speed, and then you gradually let on the clutch and give a little gas like you would on a regular motorcycle, and it starts going. But if you're somewhere and you do want to kill the engine right off, you just hit this kill switch right over here, and then just start pedaling again, pop the clutch, and it starts right back up. And that just simplifies the engine so much by not having that pull start, which are prone to breaking because you get frustrated when it won't start and you can pull, 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 then you break the cord, break the cable, and have to get a new assembly. And so it's just, and it just saves so much room. All right, so let's talk about miles per gallon. So the standard tank that comes with it is 2 liters, basically a half gallon. Now you may see these advertised for 150 miles per gallon. From the videos I'm seeing, that just really isn't realistic. What I'm seeing is most people seem to be quoting about 75 miles per gallon. Now, I did a 75 mile break-in period where I ran a heavy oil mix, so I wasn't able to calculate it, plus being in the mountains, it's really hard to do. But I'm anticipating probably between around 60 miles per gallon, maybe how I drive. So how do you make the gas? Well, it's a mixture. So I got a 1 gallon gas can. I buy a gallon of premium gas. I don't know if you have to use premium, but it's so cheap, for you, why not? And then during the break-in period, so I buy 1 gallon, and then I have my two-stroke oil here, and it allows me to measure it out in the top. So I put 8 ounces per 1 gallon for the break-in period of about, I mean, I did 75 miles, 100 might be better, and that will give it more oil than it needs to help it seal up. And these aren't, you know, the quality of these casting engines is not the great, so they do need to seat in. And I noticed when I hit 20 miles, the compression went up dramatically, and so did the fuel economy. So it takes a while for them to set in. You don't want to be flooring it. You want to do different throttle speeds and just don't give it full throttle very often, and it'll start settling in. Now they are they're pretty strong. The metal's a little soft, so you got to be careful when you're tightening bolts. And after each run, when you're breaking it in, you need to tighten these two, tighten these four, and tighten these two back here, and just check them all. These really, at 20 miles when I checked these definitely, I think they needed about a turn and a half, because this metal all starts seating in, and this will definitely get loose. So that's something you have to check on. Now that I'm finished with the break-in, now what I do is I take 1 gallon of gas and I just put in 4 ounces of two-cycle oil. So now, as far as distance, this is one of the big benefits of this setup over the electric bike, is you basically can have unlimited distance. And you're saying, well, they don't sell two-stroke gas at the gas station. That's not a problem. You can get one of these literally small bottles. So if I'm doing my math right, if I pulled over to gas station and I put in 1/2 gallon of gasoline, I just have to add 2 ounces of the two-stroke oil, and there's 6 in this bottle. So there's 3 tanks worth of oil that could easily go in a pack or a backpack or something. You can see it's pretty small. Another option that I got is I've got this fuel bottle, and this is not a water bottle, looks like one, and it's aluminum, but it's made specifically for fuel. And then I've got my water bottle holder here, which is not the best, which is not the best setup. I'm having trouble getting it in one hand. But basically this sets in here. So if I'm not paying attention and I completely run out of gas, I've got this bottle, which is 750 milliliters. So that'll be good for quite a few more miles to get me either to a gas station or get me back home if I'm not paying attention. So what about the legality of taking this out on the highway? I've taken this out on the highway several times on state and federal highways, of course not on the interstate. I've had police drive by me several times and they've never stopped, never said anything to me. And other people I've seen online, the only time they've been stopped is not having a helmet. Even in states that didn't require a helmet technically, because this isn't really clear whether this is a bicycle or a moped. But the policemen were just stopping and saying, hey, this is motorized, you're going fairly fast, you need to wear a helmet. And they weren't ticketed or anything like that. This is a link to a website which will have information about gas bikes and gas scooters and electric scooters, electric bikes, that'll be helpful. You can look up in your state. In the video for the electric bike, I go over the bike alarm, which I have, which is pretty cool. And it goes on. You can put the remote in your pocket when you leave, and it goes by vibration. If you want to see more about that, just go look at the e-bike video all about that. Now, one thing I didn't go over in that one was the speedometer. I really like the speedometer. It just looks cool. You can put it just about anywhere. This is a wireless one. They're not that expensive. And so I just love the look of that, because I was kind of going for a retro old motorcycle look. And so this one is wireless. So all you have to do is put this one here. And they're quite easy to mount. Here is the transmitter, and then you get a little magnet. And so you put the magnet and you twist it on such that, and there'll be a little mark on here, and you want to make sure that that magnet passes by here. And once it does, it'll start clicking off, and then we'll send the information up to the head unit. And the only setting you really have to do in the head unit is you'll need to know how wide the tire is in millimeters. You can measure it yourself and convert it to whatever. They also usually comes in the paperwork, usually comes with a chart, and you can just look at your tire size, and it's look at your tire size, and you can cross-reference that and put that in. But the more accurate you are in this distance in millimeters, the better accuracy you're going to get with your odometer. So it does speed, it does, you can reset it. So you can see right here, I've gone a total of 82.5. It's got a resettable trip one. It gives a lot of other information that I don't really use, but it's really helpful to have that. There are quite a lot of people online and groups that are just love these gas-powered bikes. Now, I forgot to mention up at the top that this is, you'll see this if you're interested in just learning information and seeing the parts, do a search on 80cc bicycle. that's going to bring everything up that's related to it, parts and everything. It's not an 80cc engine, and they're actually a 66cc engine. However, at some point the rumor goes, or the story goes, that somebody started advertising theirs as 80cc, and so everybody followed suit and did the same thing. So you'll see it listed as 80cc, 66cc, everything kind of comes listed under 80cc. And of course, if you're going to do a retro bike, you got to have the bell. I also got this battery-powered front light. It's LED, you just click it right here. I don't anticipate running it at night, but if I did, I have it. So I got this cool tail light, and one of the things I like about it, it has this little laser option. And I'll show you a picture of this. This puts a line around your bicycle at night, helps people see you. You can turn that on and off separately, and then the LED has a bunch of different settings. So this is good for safety. All right, it's time to take this thing out on the road and see what it'll do. So just click on the link right here, and that'll take you to part 2, the road test.